Welcome to the second but first authentic and official episode of the Christine Flowers podcast, Thinking, Complaining, and Dreaming Out Loud. I'm really happy to reach out to those of you who have done me the honor of clicking on this podcast, clicking on the link, and listening. And I say it's the first authentic podcast because earlier today, I recorded a very short sort of inaugural greeting where I introduced the subject matter of the podcast to you, in which I said, bonjour et bienvenue. I was a language major in college. And I gave you sort of a sneak peek at what we were going to be discussing in the episodes to come. But this really is the inaugural episode where you get who I am, where I come from, where I'm going, what I think, how I complain, my dreams, and my hopes. And to those of you out there saying, well, why should I care? I'm actually not sure that I have a specific detailed answer for that, other than the fact that I'm kind of uncensored these days. I used to write for the Philadelphia Daily News and the Philadelphia Inquirer, and I was reined in a bit by my editors, told in no uncertain terms, but in a very polite, veiled way, that there were certain topics I couldn't touch, certain opinions that I needed to sort of grind down with their sharper edges and just, I suppose, be a bit more palatable to their reading audience. And for 17 years, I managed to do that. And then there was a point at which the Inquirer decided I was no longer keeping faith with their philosophy of don't offend. And I was unceremoniously let go in March of last year. So it's been exactly a year that I have not been writing for the Philadelphia Inquirer and the Philadelphia Daily News, my hometown newspapers. However, I do still write for the Delaware County Daily Times. And that editor has allowed me a bit more freedom in the way that I express my views and myself. And that can be seen in the hate mail that I've been getting and some of the online comments. But I think that that's important. I think that this ability to have tense, passionate, engaged, as respectful as possible, but not, you know, tea time etiquette style respect, to have those attributes in a debate, in an exchange, are extremely important. And so while I do miss writing for the Inquirer and the Daily News, I'm enjoying the ability to communicate my message to an even wider audience, except with this voice right now, which is due to my second COVID shot. Thank you, whoever was behind the Moderna vaccine, and also allergies, as pollen is falling lightly upon my shoulders from the trees above. The voice will probably change in future episodes of the podcast, but I really am happy to be able to reach out directly and talk about the things that are extremely important to me and hopefully important to you. So I would invite you, if you like what you hear in the next few minutes in this episode, to click on my future episodes. And I can promise you that the style, the manner, and the substance of this inaugural episode is going to be representative and typical of what you'll hear in future chapters. I'm not going to hold that much back. And I think that being the child of Italian-Irish immigrants, you would expect no less from me. And speaking of that, we arrive at the topic of this particular episode, and that would be the fact that I am a child of Italian and Irish immigrants. Emphasis on the Italian immigrants. I'm sure I'll talk about my Irish relatives at some point in the future. However, I did see a book the other day as I was strolling through my local Barnes & Noble on the shelf in the history section, which said, How the Irish Saved the World. And I thought, oh, I like that. That's really nice. And then recent events in the city of Philadelphia, in the city not of my birth, that being Baltimore, but the city of my upbringing, the city where my heart is steeped in the waters of the waters, you can tell I'm a Philadelphian, of the Schuylkill River, and in the air breathed, is that correct, by the founding fathers and by Grace Kelly, Princess Grace of Monaco, and so many, and the geeter with the heater, that would be Jerry Blavitt, and so many other famous Philadelphians, Mario Lanza from South Philadelphia, Bill Cosby, who I still love from the Richard Allen Projects up in North Philadelphia, the magnificent Italian singers from South Philly and West Philly, the Boys of Bandstand, the great opera singer, Marian Anderson. Just there are so many great, great Philadelphians, and I am very proud to live and breathe and flourish in their august shadows. But anyway, my city is dear to me. And so anything that I see happening that I think is a blight and a blot on her reputation is quite upsetting to me. I'm also an attorney. Actually, I'm an immigration attorney. So when I see civil rights and human rights abuses based on ethnicity, based on identity, based on who we are, who I am, I get really angry. And that's why I'm outraged at what our current mayor, Mayor Jim Kenney, proud son of Irish immigrants, is doing in the city of Philadelphia to the Italian American residents. Now, Jim Kenney will not admit that this is what he's doing. But he is waging a stealth crusade against the Italian Americans of Philadelphia. You might doubt that. Well, let me give you some examples of what he's recently done. A couple of years ago, Jim Kenney removed, under the cover of darkness, a renowned, well-appreciated, beloved statue of our first and only Italian-American mayor in the city of Philadelphia, and that would be Frank Rizzo, former police commissioner of the city of Philadelphia. He removed that because he was, I guess, bullied into it by a lot of Black Lives Matter activists, social justice activists, and you can't see me using my little fingers for air quotes. Yeah, I'm using the fingers for air quotes, nothing else. But he did that without due process, without going to the courts. He simply lifted the statue under the cover of darkness because he was a coward. And when we all woke up the following morning, Mayor Rizzo was gone. From his place of prominence in the center of the city in front of the Municipal Services Building. We don't know. The average Philadelphian doesn't know where that statue is right now. For all we know, it could have been destroyed. I don't think it has been, and friends that I have who are much more in the loop on this particular issue have assured me that it has not been destroyed, but it's been hidden from the light of day because a lot of triggered social justice activists trembled in the shadow of Frank Rizzo. So that was number one. And then we had a statue of Christopher Columbus down in South Philadelphia, where I happen to work. A wonderful statue that was gifted to the city of Philadelphia and the people of Philadelphia by the Italian government over 150 years ago. That statue has reigned victorious, triumphant, over Marconi Plaza, the site of many Christopher Columbus Day parades. And we'll be getting to that in a moment. However, Mayor Kenney, urged on by his woke progressive clan, decided that he was going to take that statue down as well. Except this time, the Italian Americans of Philadelphia were ready for him. And in the person of a great advocate for Italian Americans and, more importantly, constitutional principle, a great attorney by the name of George Bochetto Esquire, a renowned Philadelphia attorney and Philadelphia lawyer in the best sense of that term. George Bochetto led the legal charge to protect and prevent that statue from being pulled down. Now, Mayor Kenney, in a sort of like a hissy fit, decided that, well, if he couldn't take the statue down, he was going to cover it up, which is exactly what he's done. He's erected non-transparent wooden plank panels around Christopher Columbus. So essentially, Columbus is sitting in a vertical coffin at Marconi Plaza. However, he is still there. And the fact that that statue is still there, and I call him he because there's a personality. That's not just marble. That's not just stone. That's not just beautiful, inanimate material carved by Italian expert stone carvers. That statue represents the people, the Italian American people of the city of Philadelphia. And so, in fact, it does have a spirit, a soul, an essence. And that's why I address it as a living creature. And through the amazing, exceptional work of George Bochetto, that statue may very well and may likely remain in its place, its deserved place of honor, for generations to come. And that's annoyed Mayor Kenney. Which brings me to the third nail in the coffin. And that would be Mayor Kenney's decision, unilateral yet again, and without consulting the community, to eliminate Columbus Day from the municipal calendar of holidays. We added a holiday this year called Juneteenth. Juneteenth is that day in June when the Emancipation Proclamation was announced and when slavery essentially ended in the United States. And I happen to think that's an important holiday to be celebrated and recognized. And I'm quite happy that that holiday is now an official holiday in the city of Philadelphia. But what Mayor Kenney did was he honored one group of Philadelphians, the African Americans of Philadelphia, and then decided to insult another group of Philadelphians, the Italian Americans of Philadelphia, by eliminating the Columbus Day parade, the Columbus Day holiday, and the parade that is an important part of that holiday. He didn't do it by going to a court. He didn't do it by asking for the people of Philadelphia to vote on it. There was no referendum. And frankly, as an executive action, he arrogated unto himself the right to do that. The problem is that in doing that, he may very well have violated the Equal Protection Clause of the federal and the state constitutions. The Equal Protection Clause, for those of you out there who have heard about it but aren't actually sure what it means, in very simplistic layperson terms, means that you cannot treat people differently. You cannot treat people who are similarly situated differently. You cannot discriminate, in essence, against people based on their religion, based on their gender, based on their ethnicity. And that is exactly what the mayor of Philadelphia has done in choosing to eliminate the Columbus Day holiday and rename it Indigenous Persons Day. Now, no one in the Italian American community with whom I've spoken believes that there should not be a holiday honoring the Indigenous who lived in the Philadelphia area before many of the Western immigrants arrived. In fact, the city of Philadelphia, Penn's Woods, the city of Philadelphia founded by William Penn, has a long storied tradition of recognizing, respecting, and appreciating the contributions made to this area by our Native Americans, in particular, the Lenape tribe. But the problem here is not that the mayor wants to honor the Native American and Indigenous populations. The problem is that he took away one holiday and gave it to another group of people. He essentially discriminated against one ethnicity to advance and respect and please or placate another ethnicity. And you really can't do that. George Bochetto knows that because George Bochetto is a brilliant attorney. And George Bochetto, along with his legal assistants, has prepared a magisterial complaint against the city of Philadelphia. And most especially the head of that city, the executive of that city, Mayor Jim Kenney. So score one for the Italian Americans. Score two for the Italian Americans in the person of Mark Squilla, who is a Philadelphia city councilman. Mark Squilla is a proud Italian American, and he has joined in that lawsuit as a plaintiff. Imagine the courage that takes for a member of the Philadelphia city government to stand up and say, I am going to add my voice publicly to a lawsuit filed against the chief executive of the city that I serve. Incredible courage, incredible dignity, incredible integrity. So score two for the Italian Americans in the city of Philadelphia. And then we have my friend Robert Petrone, a prosecutor, an attorney himself, a historian, and a wonderful writer who has written an exceptional series of articles about Christopher Columbus. They are scholarly articles. They're not opinion articles. The type of things that I write, the type of things that sort of grab you by the jugular and make you think, make you angry, or make you clap, or make you jeer, or make you curse. I'm in the business of making you react. Robert Petrone is in the business of making you think. And I would commend to you his series of articles on Christopher Columbus at a fabulous website called broadandliberty.com. Score third point for the city of Philadelphia and the Italian Americans of Philadelphia. And then you have the great Senator Vince Fumo, who really is at the root of this all. We come full circle here because, as I said before, Jim Kenney and Vince Fumo started out together, or rather, Jim Kenney started out under the tutelage and the mentorship of Vince Fumo and more. And then we have the great Senator Vince Fumo, another proud Italian American, who, but for his tutelage and mentorship, Mayor Kenney, proud son of Irish immigrants, proud Irish American boy from the streets of South Philadelphia, would not be in City Hall at this point. So score four for the Italian Americans of Philadelphia. And then we have the great Ralph Cipriano. Ralph is an investigative journalist of incredible talent and great courage. He worked for many years at the Philadelphia Inquirer. We're both refugees and or alums from the Inquirer, but Ralph is a real journalist. I just have opinions. Ralph excavates facts like a coal miner excavates coal, and then he presents it in prose that is that reaches poetry. He is the power behind a blog called BigTrial.net, and that blog is worth every single paper in this region in terms of its ability to inform, investigate, and basically give us the information that we would otherwise not have access to. He has done some incredible investigative reports on the District Attorney of Philadelphia, Larry Krasner, and that will be a topic of a future podcast episode. But Ralph, in his most recent blog article, Jim, has discussed the lawsuit that is filed by George Bochetto and the Italian-American organizations against the city of Philadelphia. excuse me. And he's also highlighted some of the other journalists in the city of Philadelphia who do not believe that Italian Americans have a right to be upset about attacks on our heritage, and who do not believe that it is legitimate to call Italians an ethnic group that is being discriminated against. And so Ralph has done us a great service. Score 5 for the Italian Americans of Philadelphia. And so when I said before that I was in the bookstore and I saw that, excuse me, I saw that book called How the Irish Saved the World, it made me think that there should be an article or a book called How the Italians Can Save and Are Saving the City of Philadelphia. And with that, because my voice is fading, not my spirit, but my voice, I want to wish all of you a great good evening. I'd ask you to please visit the sites that I've mentioned in this podcast, bigchild.net, Broad and Liberty. Go read the great works of my friends, Robert Petrone, Ralph Cipriano. Read the stories about the great George Bochetto. And you can do a little bit of deep diving into some of the works that I've done at the DelcoTimes.com as well in this topic. But more than anything else, have a great, peaceful, happy, prosperous evening. This is Christine Flowers, and this is my blog, Thinking, Complaining, and Dreaming Out Loud. See you soon.